Donald Trump being the headmaster of this whole accusations behind them trying to overturn this election, he has ways that he's also trying to find a way to get away from this, at least push this whole trial date back and change things. Because as we talked about before, he's coming after the judge that has set it for March 4th, right dead in the middle of this campaign season. This is what he's looking to get for against Judge Chutkan, because District Judge Tanya Chutkan has laid out that March 2024 trial date, and it may depend largely on her ability to keep the pre-trial proceedings on track. That's what she's looking for to do this. So far, she's shown an extremely no-nonsense approach to scheduling and little patience for unnecessary delays, which might be why he's so upset at her all the time anyway. By the way, that March 4th date was 2 months later than what Jack Smith actually was seeking for it. They were trying to get this done in like January. So at least this is some kind of stretch for him. Donald Trump's still upset about it though. But he is trying to find a way to still finagle the system. Here's some ways that he could potentially move his trial date yet again. He says he's going for the executive immunity claim. Simply because he was the president, he says he can do whatever the hell he wants, include break laws. Okay. Core First Amendment issues. Again, that's the claim that they think they can speak forward and say that all I said was that I think the election wasn't necessarily on the up and up. Nothing about their attempt to overturn it by lying and convincing and leaning on people. And lastly, they're looking to they're alleging selective prosecution. Yeah, because certain folks that just don't like him is the basis behind that. I guess they're trying to dig into everyone's brain to see exactly how that works. Let's look at that executive immunity claim though, more from CNN. Because in several of the legal proceedings he's faced, Trump has pushed arguments that he should be immune from court action because his actions fell within his duties as president. One of his duties as president include the things that they've been accused of. The January 6th federal crime case looks like it will not be an exception to that pattern that he's going with. And Bill Barr though, who worked with him, attorney, he was part of the whole thing. He was skeptical about that approach too. He's one of the big names that has since flipped around on Donald Trump, and people don't talk about him as much, but here he is dispelling that possibility.
And they're also saying that he was just exercising his First Amendment right here. Do you think that's a valid argument in your view?
No, I really don't think that's a valid argument because, you know, as the indictment says, you know, they're not attacking his First Amendment right. He can say whatever he wants. He can even lie. He can even tell people that the election was stolen when he knew better. But that does not protect you from entering into a conspiracy. All conspiracies involve speech.
All conspiracies involve speech. One part that stuck out to me about that, when he said he knew better about whether or not he lost, that was a big selling point, but that was a big point from the January 6th committee, talking about how many people legitimately told him multiple times, yo, you lost, legitimate, you lost. We heard that tape from Brad Raffensperger down in Georgia when he said, listen, you lost. This is why I know you lost. We checked it 4 times at your behest, and we still have that same answer. You lost, bro. So he can't be told this 25 to 30 times and still think that he actually won, because people that you would assume he trusted told him the opposite. One of them, of course, I guess, being Barr here as well. So his executive claims, he's dispelling that as well. Let's go to the selective prosecution part. He says, we also anticipate a selective prosecution motion, given the fact that this prosecution provides an advantage to these prosecutors' boss, who is running a political campaign against Trump, which everybody knows about. That's more from Trump's attorney saying that somehow Biden is running this whole operation. It's an easy thing to tell a bunch of the supporters that Biden, the sleepy one, who can't do anything like walk or think or eat for himself, is the mastermind behind all this. Your last thoughts on this here, Ray?
Yeah, I think that none of these, you know, interlocutory appeals that Trump has sort of been highlighting for these campaigns, previewing, if you will, have any merit to them. That being said, I don't see how we can get through these, you know, prosecutions without the Supreme Court having to weigh in on the executive immunity claim. I think it's inevitable because we are, you know, it is an unprecedented, the charges are not unprecedented. Who's being charged is unprecedented. I don't think there's merit to the argument of executive immunity, and it's something that the Supreme Court has weighed in on the past with Richard Nixon, but it didn't end up mattering because they didn't end up prosecuting him. So I think that they will though have to eventually, I think that's the only one that's gonna make its way up. And I think eventually the Supreme Court will have to weigh in on that. And I actually have faith, even in this god-awful Supreme Court, I have faith that it won't turn out the way that he's hoping it will. Even a conservative Supreme Court, I can't fathom a way in which they could justify ruling that executive immunity would be so broad as to cover all of his crimes. There's just, yeah. It's just not possible. I mean, and even someone like Bill Barr, one of Trump's biggest former sycophants, who highlighted executive privilege and executive immunity, you know, in his defenses of Trump in the past, is admitting that it's a bad theory to base your defense off of. But I mean, you gotta throw everything at the wall and see what sticks.
I hope I'm not remembering it incorrectly, but I thought Barr was also one of the folks that later we discovered Trump was actually trying to use to do specific legal moves and motivations for his purpose, as they talk about how somehow President Biden is forcing people to do this just on behalf of going after Donald Trump. So the irony just keeps circling itself. So the Supreme Court could potentially be the one to do it. But I wonder if there's such a thing, maybe for the first time, only I can remember, the Supreme Court has maybe used up all of its political capital. Usually that's for presidents or people just get in office, or maybe they've been around for too long and they have no more power. But after the Roe v. Wade decision, and see how much opposition came to that, and these litany of things they've been going against that people hate, I'm not sure if they get more gun shy. Maybe that's part of it.
And it wouldn't even be the first time that they've ruled against Trump, right? Because they ruled against his arguments and the arguments that he didn't have to reveal his tax information. You know, it's a different sort of situation, right? But I mean, this is a Supreme Court, and it with the January 6th case, Barr, Justice Thomas, they all ruled that in favor of, you know, presenting the evidence against the people involved in January 6th. So I actually don't think that he's gonna find the allies that he thinks he will at the Supreme Court. And I think that part of it, you're right, is that they have used up their political capital. And I think that some of them are realizing how deeply unpopular they are. I mean, we have Justice Alito writing op-eds about how sad he is that people dislike him. So, I mean, I do think the political capital weighs into it heavily, but at the end of the day, I just think that there's no legal way to even, I mean, I've seen them justify some heinous stuff with some absolutely BS legal arguments. I just don't even know how they could do that in this case. There's just no substance to this whatsoever.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.